Hello everyone, thanks for attending. I want today to report on the progress done on my PhD with the title Efficient High Performance Computing Techniques for Multidisciplinary Design Optimization. Today I will specially concentrate on the acceleration of turbomachinery steady CFD simulation on GPU. So let's start first by defining what is a GPU. It's a piece of hardware almost in every computer nowadays, and it's kind of subcontractor for the CPU to deliver very nice pictures on the monitors. Pictures like these are nice pictures, but let's also appreciate how accurate they are. You can appreciate here the lighting, the shadow, even the clouds and this. It's not an easy image. Every pixel have been calculated solving some small equations, that's pseudophysics equations. And the GPU does that very, very fast. This is what we will take. So what does this has to do with what we deal with in turbomachinery, where we are mostly concerned about the increase of performance and efficiency. If you reduce it to the shape optimization of such a blade, you will go to steady CFD simulation. With steady, I mean, given a certain physical boundary condition on the inlet and in the outlet, you will finish with a unique solution. So your CFD solver will keep updating a start solution until it converges. And then think of every point in the mesh as a pixel, and we will give it to the GPU. The GPU will then tell us what's the flow on every cell, not based on pseudoscience, but solving Navier-Stokes equations. And we hope that we'll have the same speed up like the graphic guys have in video gaming, for example. And why we care about the acceleration on CFD, if it's working well, why we should invest time and money on changing the hardware. What we have in VKI for the multidisciplinary optimization is a system where you have a design space. You don't know your objective. If you would know it, it would be easy to find the maximum if you are looking for a maximum. So we start the optimizer. Using, for example, differential evolution, we'll be blind, we'll suggest some designs to be evaluated. You give them to the CFD and the computational structural mechanic. Both simulation will tell you how good is this candidate, this design, for shape of a blade or whatever you are optimizing. Based on your feedback, we hope that the differential evolution will, with the time, bring you next to the optimum if you are increasing performance, or to the minimum if you are decreasing some kind of losses. So if it's working well, why they need me? The only thing is the CFD takes a few hours while the structural mechanic takes a few minutes. So there is really a need for acceleration, and we want to use the GPU for that. And the need is not just academical because we want to show some acceleration, but think if you have a time budget, you start with the design you want to improve, and you have, let's say, 1 week. If someone makes your CFD runs 10 times faster, you will have the possibility to explore 10 times more designs. So probably you will reach better improvement. So it's a real life problem here. I think now you got what the problem I'm dealing with. Now I will show you the solution I thought about. I will be using the GPU to accelerate the CFD solver. So we will have to look about the numerical scheme that I will be implementing, then how I have done it on the GPU, then some benchmark solution to see if we really had the speed up, if it's really going fast on the GPU or not. So in order to situate the GPU in the high-performance computing ecosystem, we need first to define what do we have in high-performance computing system. We have the normal class workstation. Everyone in his office, he has something like that where the processors share the same memory. There is a limitation here that the number of processors is really limited. You cannot go to a large number of them. If you want to go for hexascale, you would need 1,000, for example, of processor. You need to go to the clusters. Then you need to care yourself for the partitioning of the data and then for the communication. What we need in massive parallel systems like GPUs is kind of trade-off where we keep the shared memory because we don't really want to care about communication. But then we want to increase the number of the processors to have also a few thousands. You will then have to pay with the size of every processor. I say that the GPU has thousands of processors, but they are not to compare with the CPU processor. They are reduced to the core of computing. The ALU means arithmetic logic unit, so it's there for computation. When we compare a processor in the GPU and on the CPU is very generic. You will hear music, you will surf internet and do computation on the CPU. So they need a large cache, control unit, and only a small portion is used for computation. Whereas on the GPU, most of the resources, the transistors, are packed for computation, so arithmetic logic unit. To simplify it, you have a kind of Swiss knife and then a very efficient one, but only for cutting. Good, so let's move to the numerical scheme. What I'm solving, what I'm dealing about with is the Navier-Stokes equations. Here you have the integral form, and then our variables are in the conservative form, where you have the density, the velocities, and the internal energy. From the equation, we can see that the change in time of the volume integral of our solution, so the average in every cell, depends on two space integrals. One surface integral with the convective flux and the viscous fluxes, so the fluxes around the cell, and this source term, which is an average in the cell, so it's a volume integral. Once you finish the space integrals, you can pack them in a term called residual, and you are ready to make the time integration. Your time integration will follow this scheme if you are doing steady CFD simulation. We have here the solution change, which is the difference, so the update from time point n to time point n plus 1. It depends on a combination of the residual. With residual, we mean these two integrals at time point n and at time point n plus 1. And if you know, when you know that the residual depends on the solution, means in order to have the solution at time point n plus 1, we need the residual, which depends also at the same solution that we don't have. So when I faced this problem, it was so scary that I said, let's set beta to 0 and then finish with this term. And fortunately, I was not the only one thinking like that. It has even a name, explicit time stepping, where your system, the update of your solution depends only on data that you already have. With this n means at time point n. So in order to have the state at time point n plus 1, use data that you already have. It's kind of straightforward. We implemented it. I showed it, the solve I showed last year. We had the speed up of 30. And then we made an optimization of compressor cascade. The results I showed in an applied math conference in Greece in September. Here are two slides, and I have additional slide about optimization if we want to go into it. So the compressor is, what was it? The Mach number was 1.3, and then we had the flow with an angle minus 60, making a turning of 4 degrees. So you have a bow shock that transforms in a normal shock, and then it will interact with the boundary layer, having some mixing layer. So I don't want to really go into the physical for the moment, but I was happy to see that the optimizer using the GPU solver was able to make this normal shock into a partially oblique one, where you see that we have the same legend, so the same scaling. We don't have a lot of red here, so overall we reduced the peak Mach numbers and the pre-shock Mach numbers have been reduced. And that allowed us to reduce the entropy. If you take a cut at the output where you have the wake in the middle, you see that we have between the baseline and the optimized a kind of offset. So what we have been doing with the optimizer is more or less improving the shock losses. You see here that blue is better than green, and it was all green when the shock was normal. Making it partially oblique allowed us to reduce the losses. We can go back to this at the end if you want. My point here is that I made this optimization 30 times faster than one CPU. But we tried then, taking these good results, we tried other test cases. Unfortunately, we have seen that the explicit time stepping is not kind of, it's not a stable solver. It will work for some test cases, but not for others. So we were obliged to really face this term, where you set beta equal to one, you are then in an implicit time stepping. If you do a linearization of this residual, it will depend on Jacobians, that we call Jacobians, the change of the residual based on the solution. And then if you take this inside this equation at the end, you will have a linear system of equations where the solution change is no more depending on some simple residual, but it will be the solution of a linear system of equations. The right-hand side is the usual residual that we know how to compute. This is a system matrix where we have Jacobians, something new we never computed on the GPU, plus the time step. Let's focus on the implicit solver. It's a stable, but we need to solve a linear system of equations. It has this form, a generic form of AX equal to B. And when you are solving a linear system, first you need to fill your system. So there is an assembly phase where you fill your system with data. Then you retrieve the solution. The one I call assembly, or it's called assembly, where you assemble. So first let's start. This is your solution. It's the state, the update of the solution on the mesh solution. Then you need to fill the right-hand side. As I said, it's easy. It's the residual. What is new is building your system matrix. It's a sparse matrix. Sparse means most of the places on the matrix they have zeros, and we have some non-zero elements in kind of lines here in the diagonals, depending on the scheme you are using. For structured meshes, you will have something looking like that, where let's consider now the time step. We will divide by the time steps for all the elements sitting on the diagonals. And so we have chosen the implicit time stepping because we can go to larger time steps. But if we go to larger time steps, we'll divide by a large number. At the end, the number sitting in the diagonal will not be the biggest of all the row. And if you meet an applied math expert, he will tell you if you don't have the biggest number in a matrix sitting in the diagonal, you lose something called diagonal dominance, and then you don't have any guarantee that a normal iterative solver will solve this system. So you will give it to a linear solver, it will iterate a lot, and you don't have any guarantee to converge or to have any sensible solution. For that, you need to rearrange your system. If you really want to go for large time steps, and this is what we want to do, you need to rearrange your system. You see that? Okay. This matrix we call preconditioner. It's responsible for rearranging the system in a way that to make it easier to solve. And the matrix itself should be something easy to invert. You can fill it, for example, with an LU factorization where you take your system matrix and you make it like a product of two matrix, L and U, an upper fill. It's kind of detailed, but it's a factorization of your system matrix. Let's move now to the solver itself. I have two versions. Standard version I will show now. What we can learn is that the GPU, anyway, cannot be a standalone hardware. It's a coprocessor. It needs a CPU to initialize the problem. Really? Needs a CPU to initialize the problem. Then we do all the CFD iterations inside the GPU until the flow converges. Then we copy back the solution to the CPU for the post-processing. Inside every flow iteration, we need to assemble the system, as I said, and solve it. And this, we do it repeatedly in a Rangokuta scheme, an implicit Rangokuta scheme, where in order to go from time point n to n plus 1, you go through many stages where you change the Rangokuta coefficient and your residual. So since there is not enough time, I will skip the assembly phase. and speak more about the solver, which is the core of the work. When you are solving, you will give a system matrix and the right-hand side to your system. You do the factorization in order to fill the M matrix, what we call the preconditioner. And then this will go to a linear solver. And we took the flexible GMRES of Paralution library on the GPU. This library will give you your solution after some iterations. And then this iteration will tell you how easy or how difficult was it to converge. If you give a good factorization, you will converge very fast in few iterations. If you have a bad factorization, you will need more iterations. But the flow will not be touched. It will convert to the same flow. Good? When I made the standard version, I have seen that I'm even slower than a CPU. So it does not make sense to go into the GPU. So what I made is, I control now the factorization. I check if I really need to update my preconditioner or not. So first I do it, I compute the preconditioner. Then the program starts. The linear solver will solve the system and then tell you how much iteration it took to converge. Then I have a limit. If the linear solver still converges below a certain limit I give, so the preconditioner is still okay, we will survive without. When we see that the linear solver really needs a new preconditioner, then we do the update. And you can say, okay, you pay with, you do less factorization, but you do more iterations. On the GPU, the factorization costs much more than the iteration itself. That's why we have chosen this alternative, where, for example, if in one case, normally you require 100 factorization, we required only 14 out of 100, and the system converged to the same flow. For the benchmark, I will do it with a two-stage Rangokuta in a flow around the LS89. Let's not go into the detail about the flow itself, but let's consider the two meshes we have, the coarse mesh and the fine mesh. This fine mesh, having 300,000 cells, will build the system matrix with 1.5 million rows. And this is pretty much the limit of what a GPU can have in the global memory. We have 12 gigabytes on the GPU, and this is kind of the limit if you want to use only one GPU. When we made the benchmark, we made it for the coarse and the fine mesh, and you will see three types of speedups: the assembly, where we fill the system with data, the linear solve speedup, and the global speedup of all the CFD simulation. Then we are comparing the two versions of the GPU I have with the CPU parallelization on MPI, on 2, 3, and 4 processors. For the assembly, we see that the GPU is very efficient doing that. We have from almost 8 to 12 speedups, which even for a CPU processor cannot compete with. We are almost 2 or 2 point something faster than for CPUs. When we go to the linear solve acceleration, it's not looking very good. We are even, if we don't do anything, we are slower, 30% slower than one CPU. So not to compare with the parallel version. With what I call in-demand, so we do less factorization, we improve our performance, but still in the coarse mesh, we are not really competitive. In a fine mesh, where you have enough work for the thousands processor you have inside your GPU, inside one GPU, we were able to reach a speedup of 5. This is the linear solve speedup. When we combine them and we speak about the total speedup of the CFD simulation itself, the steady CFD simulation, we're able to approach the one order of magnitude speedup. And then we said, okay, let's see what happens if we go for more stage per flow iteration. And then we have seen that the more stage you use in the Rangokuta, the more advantage you have for your GPU, and then you approach the one order of magnitude speed up, and even you go beyond. And with that, I want to conclude. So today I showed you a GPU solver with implicit time stepping, showed you also an on-demand factorization, and with these two techniques, I was able to reach one order of magnitude speed up. And if we want to generalize, if you have an application where you solve a linear system of equation, if you don't need a preconditioner, the GPU will be very efficient. Give it a try. And if you have a very costly preconditioner, this on-demand trick can help you very well. So since we have results on explicit time stepping and implicit time stepping also, we want to compare them. The data is there. We will show it in a conference in the 5th European Seminar on Computing in June. Then I will move on from accelerating CFD code to accelerating meta-modeling, so building models from few points we have, building models using, for example, Kriging method. And we want to explore if the GPU can do something there. Thank you for your attention.
One question: when you showed the optimization of the compressor testing, you mentioned the factor of 30.
It's the speed optimization, not CFD optimization. The CFD was about 15%, I think, the reduction in the losses in the cascade 2D. But every CFD run was 30 times faster than if you run it in one CPU.
What is the, and I didn't understand the speed up factor of 10 that you showed on the last
time. Okay, so here, this is the whole picture of what I'm doing. I'm always solving the same equations, but I went to two alternatives. Going with the explicit time stepping, which looks simpler, uses less memory, and can have a great speed up, the 30, but then it's not always converging in every test case. So for a compressor, it converged, we had results. With the LS89, it was not even converging. So you cannot start an optimization if the CFD is not even converging. That's why we went to the implicit time stepping, where for the implicit, we have one order of magnitude speed up.
Did you make a comparison between the speed up you had of your approach with the one you could get from a classical meta model approach?
The meta modeling is the next. What do you mean with comparing to meta model? I'm here accelerating only the CFD. Yeah?
Okay, if you compare what you have now in terms of CFD with what the people would do with using the current existing meta model.
Probably we should run the case to see, but anyway, we can combine the CFD acceleration, and so I can even make the CFD results better if I use metamodeling in addition to that. So it's not a replacement for the metamodeling. The metamodeling is there to accelerate the conversions to a better optimum, but if you accelerate the CFD, you can combine it to a good metamodeling.
The last question, if I may, do you have to rewrite the whole code?
Yeah, you need to write code. Yeah, you need to write code to have the residuals and the Jacobians. But you can also say, I will keep these on the CPU and only tell the GPU to solve the system. Then it depends on your system. If you need the preconditioner, the GPU will not be the right choice. If you don't need the preconditioner, give it a try. Probably the GPU will speed up the application. And you don't need to do a great job. You use Paralution library. You give your CPU data, it will take the data, fill the system, solve it, give you your solution back.
Thank you. Okay.
Next question?
Yep.
In one of the last slides, talking about the implicit scheme, you said that in the fine mesh, you are really close to the limits of memory allocation for the grid. And that didn't seem to be a huge mesh. So
So I will tell you first why it takes, this is an extra slide I made about the assembly, why I need a lot of memory, because there is a problem when you compute something on the edge. When you do it serially, no problem. You need the value on your cell, so you do this edge, then the other. But if you do it in parallel, you will have two processors. Everyone wants to write data inside the same cell. And everyone has different data, so you'll have something we call race condition. Your result will not be deterministic. That's why I save two different results. When I compute something on the edge, I save it one time for this cell and another time for this cell. So I will take all the mesh, multiply by 8 to have the memory usage I will have. So take the mesh, multiply by 8, you will find the 12 gigabyte I have as limit.
Yeah.
you use more GPUs, or you go for another approach where you use less memory, but you will pay with less performance, less speed up. But anyway, you can go for more GPUs. Every GPU has 12 gigabytes, you go for two, for more. And this is the direction nowadays. The GPU is not a competitor for a CPU, but nowadays in every cluster then, in every modern cluster, you will have the CPU nodes with some GPUs with it to offload some kind of the job, not do all the job, but the job that is appropriated for the GPU. I answered your question.
Yes, yes, and actually with the current GPU that we have,
we have 6 or 8 GPUs, so we have 40 gigabytes, let's say, of memory you can compute. We can go for some millions, says. Few millions, not much.
Well, yeah, maybe just to continue on the previous, so why don't you have a loop over the cell faces instead? So then you could compute it only once and distribute it to the left and the right cell.
This I was answering with the problem of in the framework of parallel computing, you cannot go edgewise and compute and then save it in two different cells, because in a parallel, a processor will be computing something here and another processor is computing something there, and both wants to write data, add data to the same cell. And computationally, the addition is not associative, or I don't remember how to say in a mathematical way, but if you add a variable and another variable, computationally you cannot control, because they will copy the state of the cell, add their contributions, and copy back. So if two processors copy the content, add their contribution, one will save, and the other will save later, what will happen is one of the contributions will get lost, and you don't control. At one point, your results will not be deterministic. You run the same simulation, same input, you have different output.
Okay. I think that you could avoid that by doing some checkerboard.
Yeah, you can go for multicolored, so the multicoloring where you color the cell, the edges that are not colliding with each other, but then in the GPU there is something called coalesced memory access, so we don't need to disturb the memory access. And with multicoloring, you disturb the memory access. This is something related to the GPU. In the paper, I wrote why I went for this approach.
Another small question. Yep. So I think it depends a lot to avoid communication or transfer of data between CPU and GPU. And, are you sure you can keep this really optimal when the mesh gets bigger and bigger?
If it gets bigger, it will be, for example, multi-block, so you will send a block to a GPU and another block to another GPU. At one point, you need to do the interfaces update, then you will need to copy back to the CPU. But even for that, there is a way to copy the data, improving the bandwidth, doing it faster. But anyway, if you go for more GPUs, you need to pay for the communication, like any MPI application. The communication will have its cost.
Consider other preconditioners for the GMRES.
This is the only one. The LU decomposition, the incomplete LU decomposition, is the only one working from the library I used. If you can suggest me any other thing for a steep problem, it will be nice.
Was it the only one implemented? Or?
No, they have other implemented, but the other are not converging. They will need thousands of internal iterations and they don't even converge. Even for one flow iteration. It's called Paralution. It's new, but it's based on the GPU. Similar to PETSI in the performance, but for the GPU. And the reference code I ported is made on PETSI. And also in PETSI, it's a code from Lasse Miller. He was using flexible GMRS plus the LU. So the flow obliged you to take this way. And for the CPU, using the LU is not a problem. It's something that the CPU does very, very fast, and the GPU struggles to follow.
One last question.
Have you considered preconditioning the explicit solver to make it go
We thought about it, but we don't have no implementation on that direction. But I will consider it for the final comparison between explicit and implicit. I will consider it.
I have one last question for you. Do you see that even for the scientific computing in the academic level, the GPU has still some way to go to be optimized, to be implemented for academical codes which are favored for the GPU?
Mm-hmm.
How do you see the future of the GPU for the for more industrial users who has more, let's say, specific codes and more general computing power at their hand?
It will depend on the equations they are solving. For example, if it's particle-based, like Lattice-Boltzmann equation, then the industrial people, they will go for it because they have a lot of particles, and the GPU has a lot of processors. Every processor will take a particle and take care of all what will happen to this particle, certain particle. The finite volume is different. We don't have particle-based. You need to do another work, so that's why we don't show thousands of speed-up. We have 2,400 processors on the GPU, but I don't show a speed up of 2,400. So we are not scaling idly, but this is because of the scheme we are with the Navier-Stokes equation are solving. So probably an industrial guy will not go for GPU with Navier-Stokes.
Okay. Let's once again thank our speaker, and then we can keep on busy in the coffee break that you have on till 3:30.